about to bet on the future, of course, but to have a big picture when it comes to investment trends and investment strategies, I'll be joined to do so by two experts in economics, Jacques Crémer, professor of economics, Toulouse School of Economics, and Julien David Nitlesch, partner at Iris Capital. Please join me on stage, gentlemen. And we'll have this session divided into two parts, if you may. First, 10 minutes each to express yourself, to try to have a better understanding for us about what the new trends and strategies when it comes to investing are. And then we'll have a few questions together, if you may. Jacques, maybe you go first. And again, what is the big picture when it comes to investing? What are the major trends we should look up to?
Thank you very much, Marjorie, and thank you very much for to the IDA to invite me. And it's a very great honor. It's a little bit humbling to be the first speaker at this DG World on the occasion of the 40th anniversary of IDA. Let me tell you something about their anniversary, which they cannot tell you. You really have to be French and coming from outside of Paris and being in the French kind of extended academia milieu to understand how extraordinary is what IDAT has done over the last 40 years. Building something which is both relevant in terms of policy, industrial, and which at the same time has kept a real intellectual foundation, which has tried not to compromise the quality of the analysis in order to expand and to do something which is, you know, is really something you cannot imagine the amount of work which has gone into something like this. And that's work from, you know, people like my friend Yves, who's at the top, but also huge amount of dedication, and I think heroic dedication actually from lots of the staff. So I think we should really begin by giving them a big round of applause. This is really a fantastic job. Congratulations. So what I would like to speak to you is about how can we factor growth when we evaluate digital startups. And let me begin by a story. It's always good to do comparison, which has got nothing to do with digital. It's a story about a biotech company. Which was producing some type of medication. And I don't know the names because they were not published in the story I saw, but we know that on Friday, September 26th, on Friday, 26 September 2014, Mr. A, who was the CEO of firm X, sold some shares which he owned of that company. On the same day, a bit later, at 5:45 p.m., it was announced that X had a substantial loss in the current year, that its operating income had dropped from a negative amount to a lower negative amount. Of course, the staff of IMF, the French regulator of financial markets, got upset and said, well, you must have done, this is insider trading if I know about it. So they were taken in front of insider trading. He was sued for insider trading. His lawyers were smart enough to hire a good economic analysis, a good group of economists from the analysis group. Economists really can be useful, I promise. And they made a study and showed that actually, for firms of a type of biotechs, startups, operating incomes had absolutely no consequences on the shares of prices. There couldn't be any insider trading because the market absolutely didn't react to a very strong drop in the operating income. Of course, what the market cares about is about the quality of the products and the future profits. Now, what I would like to say is that, you know, digital startups are very, very stratified, very different from each other, but globally, I think the problem is even more difficult than it is for other startups. Predicting the future, predicting what a good investment is, predicting how well a firm is going to do is extremely difficult and has got some fundamental aspects which make it more difficult than for other startups. It's good for this to start from a recent study by McKinsey, whose ominous title was Grow Fast or Die Slow, which compares the EDIPTA of digital firms of different sizes. So they look at digital firms which are passing the $100 million threshold, revenue threshold. And they show that at that size of firms, the firms which are growing faster have a smaller EDIPTA, are less profitable than the firms which are growing at a natural pace, at a slower pace. On the other hand, when you get to the $1 billion threshold, the firms which are going faster are more profitable, have got a bigger, I can't pronounce this word, EBITDA, than the firms which are growing more slowly. Okay? So there's an inversion as the firms are changing. And this is very consistent with what economists call with the economics of platform, with the platform models. So I don't want to go into lots of detail of definition, but platforms are basically firms, websites that put people in contact with each other. IDAT is a very good example of a platform. And the problem, of course, that you have when you're a platform is you've got to prime the pump. You've got to begin getting people to begin using your platform in order for other people to use it, which means that once you've begun growing, you become more attractive. Okay? So this is very difficult for a normal product. A normal product, I don't care whether you're purchasing. If I have to choose, if I buy a Peugeot, I don't care whether you're driving an Audi. On the other hand, if I come to the IDAT meeting, I care that somebody else is in the room. So this means that there is a strong interaction between the behavior of the different consumers. The problem for investments is that we know very, very little, I think both in business terms and certainly as economists, on what are the determinants of success, what are the pattern of growth of platform, when do they grow fast, and so on. So my current research bears a little bit on this. With my co-authors, we seem to identify the fact that the importance of word of mouth is crucial in order to understand the growth patterns, because word of mouth, if a platform grows by word of mouth, it means that it's going to be very, very difficult to get the first customers because nobody's going to do the advertising for you. Once you've begun and you've got a decent platform, then your growth is going to be explosive. However, it's very, very difficult ex ante to really know whether or not the word of mouth is going to be successful, how it's going to function. We don't really have good analytical tools for this. So, in terms of recommendation, if you have a startup, this is not really helpful. It just means it's going to be a bumpy ride. If you have a platform model type of startup, you might have to wait a long time, and it's very important to work very hard to prime the pump. If you are an investor, it means you better diversify because you're not going to be able to predict which ones are going to be successful. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Jack.